talk show.
Recorded live.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Jörg Wissmann. I am again from YouTube channel Juggler66, and I welcome you and everybody else who is now listening or later on viewing the video to another show of Hour of the Truth. And we are determined to continue the reading of the booklet my good friend and brother in Christ, Walt Stickel from Oregon in the United States of America, or Romerica, as I like to call it. We will continue the reading today on the bottom of page 24, but before that we will still have a little other introduction, of course, because we were just talking about the word Nazi. How does the word Nazi come into living, you know? Many people say, well, Nazis, those are all the Germans who were in the party in that time, at the Hitler party, and all the National Socialists, those were all Nazis. But then I just want to give you a little thing to think about. Nazi, written N-A-Z-I. What does the Z-I stand for? When the party, the German National Socialist Working Party, was a German National Socialist Party. So National Socialist, you would abbreviate N-A-S-O, National Socialist, right? Where do you take the Z-I from? The Z-I actually comes from something quite different and has to do with Zionism. And Nazi has nothing to do with anybody of the so-called German Workers' Party, where Adolf Hitler was the chancellor from later on in that party, but it had to do with National Zionism. And it goes back to things like the Havara Agreement. A lot of people never even heard of the Havara Agreement. And I also have a video uploaded on my channel, I think almost 3 years now already, or even some longer. Eustace Mullins, who, by the way, was Jesuit trained, and I know Jesuit controlled, Jesuit controlled,
Shortcode.
Oh, yeah, opposition, you know, controlled opposition, Eustace
yes.
Mullins.
Mm-hmm.
Controlled opposition, that was the word I was looking for. Thank you, Walt. I know that, but he made some interesting and substantial broadcasts that one that I have here, that's a video taking 10 minutes the way he has a speech, and that's about the connection of the Nazi, so-called Nazi Zionist Party and the Holocaust, and it's about 10 minutes. You can watch it. You can find that on my channel. But there are so many people who use the word Nazi completely wrong and have no idea what it's all about, and haven't even heard of the Havara Agreement, where a Jewish businessman agreed with Germany together to make a business to collect the things that Jews possess in Germany and collect them, and then transferring them later to Palestine as German export goods. And that's in the basis why they needed concentration camp, because concentration camp means to concentrate something, means to gather something, to gather together, to collect from here and here and here, like the same stuff like you have the FEMA camps over there in the United States of America for the moment, which are not used for right now. But what's that? To concentrate people. That's concentration camps are for. And that's what they were built for in the first place, to get the people, the Jewish people and their possessions, concentrated in some places, and from there get them shipped to anything else. Anyway, I don't want to go too deep into this, but I just hate it when people use the name Nazi or the word Nazi and have actually no idea what it's meaning. And I think that's a shame. We should all start look a little bit more into the words we are using, you know. Another example is the word kids. I hate it when Americans say, I send my kids to school, I go with my kids to Sunday brawl, and I do this and I do this with my kids. Kids is something that goats have. Kids is something that animals have. We people have children. And, you know, this degenerating of words or degenerating of people, because children are people. They are little people, but they are people. And they are degenerated by this word kids. When you do that constantly, then you are being raised in a way that you know that you are not that worth, that you should be worthy, you know. You are belittled. Kids are belittled. That's why they are not always taken seriously. Of course not. They are only kids, you know. They are not little people. They are kids, like goat children, like you say. People don't have respect for that anymore. And when they don't have respect for them, when they are children, they don't have respect for them when they are older. And we use a lot of these words in an absolutely wrong way, and I dislike that. So please try to call your children the children that they are and not the kids that you name them. Just a little bit to think about, that we should call anything what it is and not using other names. And when you use the word Nazi, well, then at least understand what a Nazi is. And okay, I was ranting on a lot, Walt. Come on.
No, well, listen, my name's Walt Stickle, and I'm the webmaster for Rand Design Exposed. And no, before the broadcast, I want people, because into the broadcast here, I want to talk about the word Nazi. You know, I got something kind of heavy on my heart. I started to share a little bit with York off air. But when I started, I used to drive truck, and the computer was well on its way. My first computer was a Windows 95 when I got out of the truck. But it's a way of, right now we're using it to communicate. I'm talking with the European Union in Brussels right now, and you're talking to, I'm from the shores of Romerica. And one thing I've learned about my brother York, there's a difference between with the way he's been raised and the way I've been raised. And I've got out of my box, and York has helped me keep me in that, to see that there's a bigger box. And I've been able to crawl into his box that he's been raised in. York has been raised in post-war Germany. We're not going to go there right now, but what's on my heart is going to lead to the outskirts of this. When I started putting these books together, I got a computer. And God taught me how to. I almost threw the computer out the first 4 hours. I couldn't write a letter. I got so frustrated I was going to pick it up and throw it out on the street. As years went by, I mean, call it what you want. A truck driver learns how gets a computer. And I learn how to build websites. And I play with pictures. First thing I did was, man, I can take all the pictures I want. And I used to go down to the beach, and every place I go, I haven't been taking as many pictures the last 3 or 4 years because of the research that I've been doing. But the pictures led to learning how to build a web page. And I used to, all kinds of pictures. I've got pictures of trips I've made around here. And then I got into research, the Grand Design Exposed. And the word Grand Design comes out of Catholic literature. Malachi Martin uses it several times in his book. The only difference between Grand Design and my site is it's Grand Design Exposed. The Grand Design. And so I'm looking at this book, I learned how to make a big book, and that's up on the internet. But about 4 or 5 months ago, I learned how to put anybody, and if anybody's interested and you got some stuff and you want to print, I can show you in 5 minutes. But, it's not hard, but most people, now I had a business, an ISP business, internet service provider and dial-up for about 5 or 6 years. I'm going to share something with you. Most people that have a computer are looking at games and butts. They're not using this as the tool it really is. They've got to step down, and people are not taking advantage of this. You see, I'm a publisher now, not only a webmaster of a website, but I can teach you in 5 minutes how to publish a book. Books that are not being talked about. And as I went, over the last couple of weeks, I've met some different people around the world. But yesterday I sent a book to Michigan. I sent a book to Washington, one to North Carolina, one to Pennsylvania. And I'm getting ready to send one to Japan. It's a little spendy to send them over to Japan. I sent a book not too long ago to York. It cost me $26 to send one across the pond. Now, you say, well, where are you going with this? What has this got to do with the Jesuits today? Well, as I'm going down with this mailing list, I'd put it off, and so I had to make a nice little file and make a list when people now, when they contact me and they want a book, because I've offered 5 free books to the first 5 emails that come in. You know, people that want a book. So I'm going down to the post office, and I got all my addresses and my scissors and my tape, and I get the envelopes, and I start sliding these in to the envelope, putting them on the right, making sure that the book's in it, and I mailed off 5 different packages. And all when I was down there, and I was looking at the cover that I'd built, because I learned how to use pictures, I was looking at the 2 covers of the books that I... And, you know, a picture is worth 1,000 words. And I'm seeing people pass me by in the post office, and I'm realizing every person seeing what I'm sending, these are forbidden books. I'm holding a book right now called The Papacy is the Antichrist, a Demonstration. Now, this man, J.A. Wiley, wrote a book, and I've reprinted it. And I can show you how to pass it on, too. Here's a man. He's wrote the history of Protestantism, which extends to nearly 2,000 pages and was first published in 1878. Now, today in 2015, this book is considered hate literature. And it's going to be soon, there's going to be a day that this kind of literature, they're going to burn books like this. You remember the Third Reich and the burning of the books? Now I tell you, I want to introduce somebody that's dear to my heart. And it's right to the point what I'm trying to get across. She was born in 1921. Sophie, and pronounce her name right, York, would you? Sophie?
Sophie Scholl.
Sophie Scholl. I can't. He's been trying to teach me how to pronounce that, and I can't pronounce it. But you see, this little gal was born in May 9th, 1921. And she had a boyfriend that was on the Eastern Front. And she was raised a Protestant. And when the regime took over, even her father was a mayor of a town, and he resisted as much as possible. Okay? But people don't understand what happens when freedom of conscience is taken away from a nation. You know, the real element of the Third Reich started to take hold. And so why was her life, how could I relate it to going to the post office to mail off 5 packages? Let me tell you a little bit about Sophie. You know, she was a member of the White Rose. Let me see where I'm going to start her. Her brother had been initially keen to keep her ignorant of their activities. But once she discovered his activities, she joined him and proved invaluable to the group. As a female, her chances of being randomly stopped by the SS were much smaller. Because, see, what's happening here? What's happening, she had a boyfriend on the Eastern Front, and she was communicating. See? And she could see what the grinder that they had her nation in. They started in the summer and froze in the winter. An army of 6 million men, they head for Russia. It gets down and they bog down in Stalingrad, and it gets 30 degrees below zero. With wind, that's not counting the chill factor. It was terrible. And Sophie and many of the people back home, you know, they could see what was going on. She was a kindergarten teacher. So between June 1942 and February 1943, they prepared and distributed 6 different leaflets in which they called for the active opposition of the German people to Nazi oppression and tyranny. Several of the group members had been deployed to the Eastern Front for military service during the academic break. See, they were putting 2 to 2 together. And what happened in the end? The Russians took 96,000 prisoners. And I've seen a video of it. They show them coming across the plains, coming up a gradual slope. And as far as the eye could see, you could see Germans marching for Siberia. Only 5,000 ever got back to Germany. And my brother, Jörg, has been brought up in post-war Germany. He has had to live. And if by the grace of God, he's not bitter. He sees the propaganda, how they propagandize the Americans. And he's checked me a couple times because I get angry. And you know, York, bring up this quote and then tell me when you got it. But tell when you got it, just let me know what Churchill said about the German people.
Churchill.
Remember?
I don't have that quote right here.
Okay, well, anyway, that's not really important. But listen, where I'm going with this, now we're getting back to this leaflet. These people are distributing leaflets, okay? Walt went down to the post office, and I looked at the covers, and one of my somebody emailed me last week, one of my brothers, he's only a couple hundred miles away from me. I said, I'm going to send you a book. And he sent me his address yesterday, and I'm going to be getting that in the mail. He said, well, I don't know how many books I could give this to. That's how dubbed down and how much they've taken this away. But let's get back to Sophia. So in the late fall, the men returned, and the White Rose resumed its resistance activities. And in January 1943, using a hand-operated duplicating machine, the group is thought to have produced between 6,000 and 9,000 copies of their fifth leaflet, appeal to all Germans, which was distributed via courier runs to many cities. They had a hand-operated duplicate machine. Listen, the book that I got here by A.J. Wiley and the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy by Ronald Cook, a Protestant historian, same as J.A. Wiley. He wrote a volume of 2,000 pages. And when you use the word Protestant, people don't even know what it is today. But you and I have, everybody that's listening to this broadcast has a computer. And by the grace of God, we're still able to use it to some certain degree. My door's not being crashed down right now. But I'm going to tell you, now let's go on. What happened to Sophia? Copies appeared in Stuttgart, Cologne, Vienna, Hamburg, and Berlin, composed by Hans, that's her brother, with improvements by Hubbard. The leaflet warned that Hitler was leading Germany into the Abyss. Am I pronouncing that right? A-B-Y-S-S?
Abyss.
And which, in other words, give a little what you're... Hitler was leading Germany into...
The Abyss.
He was leading them into destruction.
Yeah, perdition.
Perdition. With the gathering might of the Allies, defeat was now certain. The reader was urged to support the resistant movement in the struggle for the freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and protection of the individual citizen from the arbitrary action of the criminal dictator states. These were the principles that would form the foundations of the new Europe. Now, on February 18th, 1943, she and her brother brought a suitcase full of leaflets to the university. They hurriedly dropped stacks of copies in the empty corridors for students to find when they flooded out of the lecture rooms, leaving before the class bell. They noticed that some copies remained in the suitcase and decided it would be a pity not to distribute them. They returned to the auditorium and climbed the staircase to the top floor. And Sophie flung the last remaining leaflets into the air. Now, this frantic action was observed by a custodian. The police were called, and Hans and Sophie were taken into the Gestapo custody.
Gestapo. That's short for Geheime Staatspolizei.
Hey,
Secret police. So, Gestapo.
Let's be authentic. We have an 100% authentic German interpretation there. Pronunciation. The other active members were soon arrested, and the group everywhere associated with them were interrogated and charged with treason. In the People's Court, before the notorious Judge Roland Freisler, and I'm pronouncing that wrong.
Freisler.
On February 21st, 1943, Sophie was recorded as saying, "Somebody, after all, had to make a start." In other words, I think that's what the hour of truth is about. Just to start. And we need to as long as we have a little bit of freedom we have, we should not shut up. What we wrote and said is believed by many others. Now, this is what she said. She says, somebody, after all, had to make a start. What we wrote and said is also believed by many others. What was put onto the German people, it was put onto them from the top down. They just do not dare express themselves as we did. Sophie and her brother's defiance, in the face of terrifying consequences, gained them enormous admiration. The grave of Hans and Sophia and Christopher in it's a German name and I'm not going to, you know, next to the prisons, Stadelheim.
Yeah. Stadelheim. The prison in Munich.
Stadelheim prison in Munich. On February 22nd, 1943, Sophia, her brother, Hans, and their friend Christopher were found guilty and condemned to death. You know, I was sharing this with York a little earlier on this broadcast. Sometimes it brings me to tears when I think how spoiled we as Americans have been. We don't have a clue what war's about. We've had this, and why are we losing it? Because we don't know where we got it from. We forgot where we got it from. It came from the cross. And we've had millions of martyrs through the Reformation to give us the Bible, give us the light, to warn us of what's ahead. They were found guilty and condemned to death. They were all beheaded by executioner Reinhardt in Munich's prison, only a few hours at 1700. They tried him, and within a little over an hour, they executed him with a guillotine. Now, this story, sometimes when I learned about Sophie, when I learned about Sophie, this gets to me. Because, you see, they demonized the Germans. One day here, sharing with Brother York, I took a picture of my father. My dad came from a family of 7 Germans. Okay, I got a picture of my dad in coveralls, holding the youngest one. And when you look back at the roots of this country, people came over here to get away from the religious suppression from the Roman Catholic Church. The papacy. And when I look at that picture, you see, and I think of York and what happened to Germany. You know, I started studying it. And I was going to do a broadcast. The more I got into it, it was hard for me to accept what really happened in Germany. And so, you know, this is where I'm going with this today. On September 23rd, we have a Jesuit Pope. We have an Antichrist. The historical, biblical, and prophetic Antichrist coming to speak. And when I pick up this book that I put together, you know, I think of Sophie. Just printing leaflets. People, this is dead serious. And another thing that got me going yesterday, Tom Fresh in York, well, I kind of hosted it that day, did a broadcast on the Pope's visit. It's got over 30 views, and I hadn't listened to it for three months.
30 views?
30,000.
Oh, that one you mean, yeah.
Yeah, 30,000, excuse me, 30,000 views. This and it's being uploaded on different channels, and people are watching this. But it shows, you know, I listened to this, and I'm telling you, there was a picture painted in that two-hour broadcast that everybody needs to listen to. And this morning, on the Hour of the Truth, I posted it on the Hour of the Truth. You can get to the Hour of the Truth by going to Grand Design Exposed and hitting button 7. I believe, no, it's not button 7, but it's Hour of the Truth. It's the top 4 or 5 buttons up there. And you can listen to this broadcast. I'm going to cut it up in 3 different broadcasts and put it up on Blog Talk. But as I'm putting all this together, I'm listening to this and I'm getting my ad and I'm getting this book together, and all of a sudden you see the relation. And that's why the word I asked York this morning before we went on air. Now in this book I got the papacy, the Vatican Jesuit global conspiracy. You know, it's just a book that I've put up that Ronald Cook, he wrote it in 1985. And it's got the word, and then I just put some key pieces of the puzzle. But I feel what I'm putting some missing information, some leaflets out that's not getting out. And I'm appealing to everybody that's listening to this is to share it. We still have a little bit of a voice. Let's use what we got. But the thought came to me this morning, and the reason I asked York about the word Nazi, would it be appropriate to say that we have if we took the word Jesuit out of that book and replaced it with the word Nazis? Now, the reason I say this, and I'm taking this from Chris Pinto, I've heard Chris Pinto say this. You see, back in 1776 in the original 13 colonies, people knew what the word Jesuit meant. That's why they had to be suppressed. They didn't. There just wasn't a big fart and they disappeared. They didn't go anyplace. They came back as the Illuminati in 1776. They never went anyplace. You know, so it's real, real important, that word Jesuit, and what is happening. It's a historical event that's happening here in another 3 months. And, you know, I hope that York and I can have a little bit of what Sophie had. You see, my heroes are not football players. They're not movie stars. My hero is people like Sophie and her brother. And it saddens me. It saddens me that my fellow Americans don't understand what happened to Germany. Oh, I'm a prime example of it. I'm a baby boomer. I was raised on war movies, glorifying war. But you know, it hurts. The truth will either make you mad or it'll make you change. And you know, I've had to change. I've had to get it, you know, because we got to turn this over. Listen, we, the victor, Christ is the victor. Revelations tells us that Christ is, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. And we still got to go on. We got to put our shoes on this morning. We got to put a smile on our face and love on our heart. And we still got to, you still got to associate with your fellow man. And the real, and once truth really gets into your head, you can't get rid of it. You can't get rid of it. And so, you know, with that, York, you know, I appreciate listening to me, because this was from the bottom of my heart, and it came to me yesterday, just mailing these books. I realize how close we are. They're not going to allow this kind of material.
Yeah, in comparison to 1933, we are now living in 1932.
You know, I've tried to place those years, and that's just about where we are. I think we might be a little bit more. We might be closer to 1936.
Yeah, but I mean, with 1933, the takeover of the Hitler Party of Germany, so the takeover of fascism.
Yes, that, I see the point you're making. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And so that's what we're, you know, and it's not. It's
we
not,
have we, don't forget we have this jubilee year. The Pope announced starting the 8th of December this year, ending the 20th of November next year. This jubilee year, that's actually, when you analyze it the right way, like we did in an earlier broadcast, that was on the broadcast with Tom Frescia on Hour of the Truth, and that was called Rome's Sodomy and Ultimatum to Protestants.
Ultimatum.
Yeah. The ultimatum to Protestants, yeah. The ultimatum, that is the Jubilee year. Mm-hmm. So it is, makes no sense to go into that right now, but people can listen to that in the archives, or they can go to my YouTube channel and watch the video of the truth, Rome's Sodomy, and Ultimatum to Protestants. That deals with the whole Jubilee year thing, because at that time we analyzed it for the first time. And Tom Frest did a very good job in making it very clear that you have to go back to Vatican II in 1962 to 1965, where the ecumenical movement was the starting of an ultimatum given to the Protestants to whether come back now under the wings of the Church of Rome, come back now peacefully by ecumenism, or else. And this or else came when you saw 1999, when the Catholic, when the Lutheran Worldwide Federation signed the accord with the Roman Catholic Church that we were dealing on for a few broadcasts, the Catholic Lutheran Accord, the paper that Richard Bennett then put together on that, and that we analyzed on this broadcast for a few times. Those were part of the ultimatum. In 2004, the Worldwide Methodist Church came on to that. You have, of course, in 1986 and 1996, you have had the meeting of the Pope in Assisi, with the worldwide with the world religion leaders, like the leader from Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism, but also shamans and all this stuff came there, and working for this one world religion that was coming. And then you have last year the starting of the building of the House of One under the name of Chrislam, the merged Christianity with Islam, the building of this one house of prayer in Germany for Jews, Christians, and Muslims. But please make sure that you replace the word Christians with Catholics, and Catholics are no Christians. And now we have the Pope coming over to the United States of America and making a speech on behalf of the American people before a joint session of Congress, and he will not only address the environment, climate change, global agenda that he has, but he will also address the poverty problems and the unrighteousness that we have between why are there so many rich people and so few rich people and so many poor people. And they are using Hegelian dialectic, and they are using Jesuitical sophistry and casuistry, that everything they say at the first glance seems very nice and very positive. But when you analyze it and when you see what it's getting behind it, it's just another ultimatum to say, have it your way or the highway. And when Rome says, you get the highway, then you will not be sitting comfortably in a car driving down a few hundred miles on a good paved highway. No, that is opening the doors to hell for your life if you do not agree with Rome. And that's what it's all going through. So the Jubilee year, you can watch that video to get a better idea of that. But this is all leading to an ultimatum that was set actually at Vatican II in 1965 when it ended. And now we are 50 years behind that. So why do you think that just 50 years when that ended, you will have a Jubilee year? Do you think that is a coincidence, Walt? Am I making something stupid up here and say, okay, but Vatican II ended in December 1965, right?
Right.
And December 2015, we start the Jubilee year. And in the Bible, that was every 50 years that everybody's debts have been forgiven and you could start anew. Well, we are not being forgiven any debts. We are not going to start again. And if we're going to start again, then we start again under the reign of Rome. And when we do not agree, then we will not start again. And we will be persecuted like never before. And that is why it is very nice of you, Walt, to distribute these books that you make now while you still can. Assure you that next year at this time next year you will be still able to go down to the post office and post whatever you want?
That's right. We got 1 minute.
Yeah, I know. Just a few seconds to go, some 30 seconds or whatever.
You know.
But you know, you have to think about this. What you are doing actually is throwing a snowball down a hill and hoping that it becomes an avalanche, and that will and that will in the end reach something and change something. When a man of 71 years old, with his experience that he has in his life and everything that he has learned, especially the last, I say 2 to 3 years. He has studied much longer than the last 2 to 3 years. But what Walt has found out the last 2 to 3 years is just amazing. And in that way, still to stand up and see the truth, and then even though you are cast down here, cast down there, and you run into unbelief here and into criticism over there, Walt has never given up. He's doing his thing, and he's even expanding his thing. And I applaud you for that, Walt. And I hope that your books will reach some people who take the advice that was written by the publisher of Rulers of Evil in the foreword of the book, when he said Rulers of Evil is a book that you should leave on the lowest shelves of the bookshelf for inquisitive children to find. I found that an amazing sentence in that book, Rulers of Evil. I love that one. Inquisitive children. The problem is most children today are not inquisitive anymore, but children normally are inquisitive and curious and want to find out things. And when you leave a book like Rulers of Evil on the bottom shelf of your bookshelf, then you will probably even see that even your child maybe be a little bit interested in things like this. And we have to get information like this out. This is the reason why I'm reading the book Rulers of Evil right now, because I'm sure there are people listening to that broadcast when I read the book who have never heard of that book before, and they can also still learn something. And Walt has learned a lot, not only in the last 2 to 3 years, of course, but over his lifetime. And we should give everybody the chance to learn the things that are really important to learn about, other than the stuff to go in school. So anyway, by that, Walt, really, I applaud you for your action, going to the post office, even putting your own money into that, and distribute these books and do this book. And I'm also looking forward to later on then reading it. But please, you want to have a comment here, I think.
Well, you know, the first hour, you know, I was talking about Sophie. But see, this relates to today. What happened in what happened to Sophie? It shows you. It relates to exactly what we're going through today. In other words, and that's why it's so prevalent. It's so prevalent. In other words, I mean, here, it's sometimes it's a little overwhelming. You know, when you learn in waves, and you realize how deceived we have. Of course, the Bible tells us the more we study God's Word, we understand prophecy, we understand revelations. And, you know, I'd like to share that. Talking about revelations, I'd like to share. I got a couple letters this last week from listeners, and I've really been blessed. I've really been blessed by this is the man. He just he contacted me on Skype, and he said thank you for adding me, Walt, and wonderful greetings. I also want to say a great thank you for a wonderful site with the great information on certain topics regarding America's founding that I had no idea. Once again, God bless you, sir, and keep fighting the good fight. And, you know, I had a chance to talk to him for a couple hours. And, you know, it's a blessing for me to see a young man in his 30s, you know, to have the understanding. And, in fact, in other words, he's a researcher himself, see. Because anything that York and I say, if we're saying something that we can't back up or something, or, you know, in other words, it's your job to refute us and keep us on track. And this other letter that I got another, this man here, he lives a couple hundred miles from me. But the way he wrote this, you know, he says, time is going by quickly. Another show is coming up tomorrow. He's talking about the hour of the truth. I find it harder now to listen to many of the shows I was listening to before. There is so much left out in what people are saying. They simply know about certain things, and it's amazing because they honestly aren't oftentimes much more mature in the faith than I. Yet I can't deny the truth. See, I liked what he said there, and amazingly, because they honestly are oftentimes much more mature in the faith than I. Yet I can't deny the truth. I mean, this is another thing that I've learned. Just because you disagree with somebody on one point doesn't. You talk about 10 points, and one you don't agree on doesn't make the other 9 wrong.
Well, it depends on which point it is that you disagree, Walt. When you disagree on something fundamental, then there's no sense of continuation of that relationship.
Well, that's true. But what I'm trying to say is when people are moving around the internet and looking at YouTubes and da-da-da-da, you know, you have to have a filter, and the filter is the Word of God, And the filter is to understand your adversary. And so, but like he says, yet I can't deny the truth. The truth, once, because the truth gets in your head, you can't get rid of it. And he says, he goes on, I just say this and then let you go. I never have been much into prophecy, although I've tried to read some books and such. It never has made sense to me until I came to believe in the historicism view of prophecy and understood futurism to be a lie. It never made any sense that the last couple thousand years nearly have been absent in Scripture. Now I realize, and in putting it together, what the Bible really means, and it's talking about the monstrosity of the Roman Catholic Church in so many places, the enemy of humanity and of Jesus Christ, the Vatican and its army of Jesuits. So thanks, Walt, for helping me understand this. I'm sure people will start waking up to this on God's time. We just have to love the truth and hold on to it. God bless and protect your family and Sammy in Jesus' name. And I got one other short comment. He says, "Hi, Walt. Just wanted to say thanks for the message on TalkShoe. Am listening to the last one now. We have a few differences in doctrine, but we know who the real enemy is Rome." And I want to comment on this. Because if you go to the website, if you've listened to our broadcast, we believe in the Ten Commandments. Not nine, but ten. Okay. And another thing, too, the only really rebuttal I get, it always goes back to Seventh-day Adventist. Like, for an example, on my webpage, I have on the main page, right down about two-thirds of the way down, I have a YouTube on Mark Woodman. Now, see, I've been criticized for having Mark Woodman on my, because he's a Seventh-day Adventist. But when you listen, the title of this is "Who is the Antichrist?" If you listened how Mark Woodman presents who the Antichrist is, you'll never doubt any again. I don't care if he's a Seventh-day Adventist. He was. Mark Woodman passed away with cancer. And I learned an awful lot from Mark Woodman. So that's what I'm getting at. I mean, in other words, the main thing that you have to know is who your adversary is. You have to stick on it. You can't call him a boogeyman, see? It's not the boogeyman out there. The boogeyman's, if you're going to hide a tree, you hide it in the forest, and they've hid it right out in plain sight. So anyway, that's what I've got for this week and some of the, I've been really encouraged, because I've realized, there's nothing that we're saying here that you can refute. The Bible cannot be refuted, and once God puts the truth in your heart, I'm going to say this before we get into this, the last half, get into the book again. Are you still there, York?
Yeah. Sorry, I muted my mic because I had to drink and I have a cold.
Yes. York's got a real bad cold today, so, and I appreciate that he's weathering the storm. But I kind of lost my trend of thought of, where I was going with this. I lost it there, York.
That's okay.
Because we were coming up on, It was an important thought, but anyway, I'm going to turn it back over. We'll start reading the book on page, I believe we left off on page 24. Oh, I know what I wanted to say. This little pamphlet, this little book, using Ronald Cook as the seed of the Jesuits, and he wrote it in 1985. There's something missing. Now, and what is missing is this. Remember always, as I should put a little insert into the book, a little article about Reformation, Romanism, Reformation, and Counter-Reformation, and the head is the Jesuit. But you see, it's so important. I mean, in other words, to understand the word Jesuit, and we say it, but you've got to repeat it. You've got to understand that they all connect. It's like the backbone connected to the neck bone, and the neck bone connected to the head bone. Everybody's heard that song. Well, it's like this. It's the Romanism. Romanism bone is connected to the Reformation bone, and the Reformation bone is connected to the Counter-Reformation bone, and the main bone, the one driving, is Satan himself, but his army is the Jesuits. And if I can, so to really get the full understanding, when we're talking about the Jesuits, you go to button 7 on my website. The most important read, the one that stirred me for months and it hit York exactly the same way, is Romanism and the Reformation by Henry Grattan Guinness. And Tom Fresh read that. I got it up there in two different pages. And you could... there's a PDF file up there. I have a place to show you where you could purchase one if you so choose.
And I have the 28 parts uploaded on video on my second YouTube channel.
And he's got it on his YouTube. I mean, that is probably to understand. You've got to understand Romanism. You can't take that out of your world history and your world views. And that's what they've done. People don't understand what Romanism is. And it's right there in front of us. And I guess, yesterday, like I said, there's some good videos. And I also put that on the Hour of the Truth homepage. I put a direct link to the Pope's visit in 2015. And that needs, and if you haven't watched it in a couple months, watch it again. I mean, I was part of it. I was there listening. I was kind of the host. So I was listening to Tom, and I was listening to York. And I'm telling you, it's the meat of what's going on. We're living in a very historical time. Anyway, that's what I wanted to. That's the only thing that's missing in this book, is realizing that Romanism, it's mentioned, but there should be to get a full meaning. I need a little article about Romanism and an article about the Council of Trent, the Counter Reformation, see, and the Reformation. So, because see, that's been taken out of our vocabulary. And it's Jesuitism. In other words, once you put all those pieces together, everything fits like a glove. So anyway, that's all I wanted to say. But it's a good little pamphlet. This is a good little pamphlet, and like I said, I look at it myself. The cover itself has got 1,000 words on it. and it would probably get me a Nobel Prize, you know, or be having me picked up by the Gestapo. How do you pronounce, you know? But anyway, that's all I got to say. But you know, we can get back to the book. But I think everything hour one, and you know, I think this is very important, because when I talked about Sophie, the first hour, that relates to exactly what we're going through today. You know, it's exactly what's going through today. So with that, you know, I'll turn it back over to you, York.
Yeah, there have always been people in resistance, you know. Also in resistance to the Third Reich and Geschwister Scholl, as they are called in German, the siblings Scholl, as you would call them in English, were one of the very fine examples of real opposition, not controlled opposition, because this is something that we miss today, real opposition. With controlled opposition we have a lot, and always had a lot. But Sophie Scholl, that was a real grassroots Protestant movement to warn the people of the Hitler regime at that time. And I don't think it is any coincidence that they have been beheaded by a guillotine, which is, I think, for a lot of Jesus Christ believing people, something they suffered in the past and probably something they will suffer in the future too. I mean, you know, when we made the videos about characteristics of Antichrist, there's this one picture, characteristics of Antichrist with a guillotine on the left-hand side. And in the United States of America, there are thousands of guillotines hidden, purchased by the government. And you can ask yourself if they maybe found a new way to chop wood, or if there's maybe something worse going on. I can tell you the second will be the right answer. You know, speaking about Jesuitism and the Jesuits, I have here a nice quote. I don't know who said it anymore because I didn't copy that one. But a nice explanation of who are the Jesuits. The church to rule the world. The Pope to rule the church. The Jesuits to rule the Pope. Such was and is the simple program of the Order of the Society of Jesus. And to it they have held fast, except on a few rare occasions of misunderstanding with the vice-regent of Christ, the Pope, end quote. I think that sums it really up. The Jesuits are, to use the expression that Walt used a little earlier, with the different bones that hang together, the Jesuits are the military arm of the vice-regent of Satan on earth, the Pope. And that's what we are dealing with, because they control it all in education and, everything. Education, economy, politics, entertainment, you name it. It's all Jesuit-controlled. And if we are not aware of it, then we will fall into the traps they lay down for us. And therefore, we have to be vigilant and watchmen. And Jesus Christ also spoke a few times over watchmen in Matthew. And what good is a watchman who is asleep, or who warns the people of the enemy when he's already in? Right?
Right.
So we have to take our role as watchmen. That's what we are doing. We are trying to bring information to people that we have gathered ourselves during our time that we were doing this. We are not paid for this. We are doing this as you can almost say as a hobby or in our spare time, and see how much spare time we have. The more time you can spend with these things, the more you can learn. I mean, 5 years ago, I was dumb and blind and stupid and was a sheep following Romanism because I had no idea of anything. And in 5 years, it changed my life. So, almost 5 years now. So you can see in a relatively short time span what you can achieve if you put your mind to it and if you want to seek the truth. And as Jesus said, when you find the truth, it shall make you free. And what is better, to be free or to be bond, Walt?
Say that again.
What is better, to be free or to be bond?
To be free.
Yeah.
And our liberty is in Christ.
Our liberty is in Christ, yeah.
Yes, it's in Galatians. You know. Galatians 5:1, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. You know,
that's a very good verse, Walt.
Yeah.
That's a very good verse. Galatians
5:1.
5:1. Interesting.
Yeah. You know, because it's and you know what's going, what the listener said, you know, the prophecy didn't mean anything to him. And it was the same with me, the same way. In other words, John gave us a prophecy. And in other words, and nothing happened. Nothing's happened since John was given revelations. And once you see the historicism, that it all makes sense. Then it just all comes together, you know.
Absolutely,
that is
of course because Bible prophecy is history told in advance.
Yes. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Well, we haven't got into the book because I'll tell you one of the reasons why, you know, that I had to share my heart this morning is because of putting this book together. I mean, putting these pieces of the puzzle. Walt didn't. Oh, I wrote a little bit of an introduction in the, you know, but. In other words, the pieces of the puzzle are there, and you learn the waves, and all of a sudden it becomes so clear of what is transpiring right now, right in front of your eyes. I mean, there's no speculation. It's as clear as a bell what's happening now. You know, and there's a lot of anytime, you know, it's amazing that I always go back to this, is when somebody doesn't have the word Jesuit in their vocabulary, and you know, you're just going to go in circles. And another thing too, is you said something off air today. We were talking, you know, nothing comes over that news. And when I was out on the truck. And I used to listen to this fellow, several lectures, 12, 15-hour lectures. And, you know, he would say this, said, you know, if you hear something on the nightly news, when you hear this stuff, and now with the Internet, they have so many shills out here. I mean, and they talk for hours and hours, hours and hours, but they never get to the point. They don't stay on the target. Who is the adversary? Who has kept us? I mean, who's our enemy? What was Romanism all about? And it's so evident what's going on now. In the last 10 years, I've been brought up. I'm 71 years old, and they got us believing that a bullet ricocheted around a convertible and killed our president, you know, and then we had 9/11. Then we had Waco, and then we had Oklahoma, and then we had 9/11, and this is constant bombardment. And, you know, some of these lies that they've taught us, you know, years ago, I was a little skeptic to throw this out because, you know, because when you say this, people say, oh, he's a fruitcake. He's a fruitcake. And what I'm about to say, like the moon landing. I mean, listen, as time goes on,
as time goes on, the evidence keeps coming out. And I'm not standing by myself now when, you know, I'm not standing by myself when I say that the moonshot was all staged. And I've been watching this movie. I don't watch much movies, but I've been watching this right stuff. And I'm a pilot. And I was watching right stuff. It's 3 hours and 12 minutes of the most intense propaganda that you'll ever want to watch. And when I watched that back in the 80s, I was actually flying commercially in the small airplanes up in the San Juan Islands. And then when you watch that right stuff today, man, oh man, what a piece of propaganda. And this is where I'm going with that. No, we can talk all day about the lie, but what has that done to our psychic? I mean, what's that done to the people's thinking as a whole? And then all of a sudden, you know, when people don't want to believe it because now they got to change their worldview, and especially if you don't have the Bible. You know, I am any more, you know, I'll tell you something. When I see somebody really twisted, and if they're not anchored in that Bible, they're going to have problems. But, you know, it's like me. Bring it on. Bring it on. There's been millions of martyrs. May I be blessed to be another one. See, I mean, and what I'm getting at is all these lies. People have been lied to so much that they don't know what, you know, black is white, white is black is black. I mean, they don't know what in is up. Oh, milk's good for you. No, milk's bad for you. Oh, no, too much of this is, no, this. I mean, they got people going at all directions, and especially the Internet. The Internet is the TV on steroids. Man, oh man, I tell you, some of the things that come over this, you know, come over the Internet, man, you got to stay right on that Bible. You got to stay right in that book. And you start listening to somebody, and pretty soon, man, he'll be telling you his philosophy. I remember when I was out in the truck, I was in Quincy, Washington, and I used to take off my weekends sometimes. I used to live in a truck. So this fellow, you know, he took me to church, and his wife was gone that weekend. So we went to a Mormon service, and then we went to an Assembly of God. And I'm going to tell you something. The Assembly of God, I mean, I don't know what I know now, okay? I don't know what, but I'll never forget it. The guy got up and talked and didn't quote one scripture. Not one scripture. And then they lit up the guitars and they started playing music. And of course, I'm still out in the truck. I'm studying Freemasonry. See, but I was studying all the false religions like Seventh-day, all the false religions like, you know, even Seventh-day Adventists, I studied that. I studied the Mormons. I'll tell you about the Mormons. There was a movie put out by, can't think of his name, an audio, a video. And I didn't have a TV, but they had a VHS in those days. And I watched this video put out by, I can't think of his name. He wrote The Dark Side of Freemasonry. I can't think of his name right now. But he actually put this video out. He was a former Mormon. And I was watching this video, and I'm telling you something. I was over in a gravel pit across from a cafe, or as far as parked for the night. And I watched that video, and about halfway through, I got up and made sure the doors were locked. You know? And I was studying Freemasonry. Oh, man, I had every book. I read every book that Tex Mars printed up until Circle of Entry. See? I mean, continually. See?
You didn't know then that Tex Mars is Jesuit educated.
Well, and plus he's a retired Air Force. See, he's a retired Air Force. He's working for the government. Okay, I mean, he's not going to say anything, you know. But the point of it is, even listen, I'm going to tell you something about Tex Mars. Tex Mars knows about Rome.
Oh yeah, okay? Of course. That's why he doesn't mention it.
Tex Mars has forgotten more than I have.
He mentions Rome. Sorry, he mentions Rome.
Yes, he's forgotten more than I know.
But,
you
also mentioned it on this website and everything, but I have a video uploaded of him on my second channel about the Jews running the whole New World Order stuff.
See,
I don't even know the title of the movie anymore, or of the video anymore that I have on my second channel, but you can watch it there. And when I learned about that he was Jesuit trained, I adapted the description and worked a little bit on the description to tell the people that he is not talking the truth in here. And I put the link into his website where he states that he is Jesuit educated, so that they can see through the deception that this video is not so so much the truth resembling as it should be.
You know, and the main thing when you're talking about like Tex Mars or somebody is not what he's saying. It's what he's leaving out. And I mean, it's just, but it's taken a long time for me to come to grips with, you know, if you've got to stay right in the Bible, you got to stay right there. And anytime somebody takes you off, they want to take you off in one of their studies. As soon as you go down that rabbit trail, you're going down a rabbit trail no end. You know, I had a minister call me up, a Seventh-day Adventist minister, and I was asking him about the feast. And he said, he said, well, you know, there's 240 mistakes in the King James Bible. End of story. I'm not going down that bunny trail. I could spend the next 2 years investigating all those 240 mistakes in the King James Bible. Man, thank you. I mean, in other words, I don't have no argument with the man. But if he believes there's 240 mistakes in the King James Bible, where do you start and where do you stop? I mean, that is a trap. That is a trap. But I'm glad we're talking about this because, you know, this is really heavy what's going on right now. And one of them is, I got to bring this up, okay, is the flat earth. They're calling it the year of the flat earth. And they got everybody and his brother jumping on this bandwagon. And you know, the Bible is very clear that this earth is stationary, okay? And I study the history, see, and I'll tell you what they're doing with this flat earth. It's New Age. It's New Age theology. They're bringing their New Age, and I'm going to tell you something, brothers and sisters. The shape of this earth has nothing to do with the shape of your heart. And they've got everybody going down a bunny trail that's taking them nowhere.
Yeah, it already starts with the two different systems, the heliocentric system or the geometric system, geocentric system.
It's the geocentric
system that is true, but it's the heliocentric system that is taught, you know?
That's right. And it's simple as that. You go back to Galileo, and Newton, he helped to get going, but they could have never got this earth traveling 66,000 miles an hour, some say 67,
and spinning at 1,000 miles an hour at the equator and traveling through space and making one turn around the sun. Now, that's what they teach, okay? But this is what's being left out of this flat Earth discussion. Is the reason why the Roman Catholic Church jumped on the heliocentric is because they could see, because the Gores and the boys, I don't know, Kepler, there was more than one guy that got this Earth going that fast, okay? And you need a little help. Listen, if Walt's got a telescope, if I got a telescope, because Galileo had is a telescope. The reason for this, brothers and sisters, is to discredit the Bible. And that was to pave the way for evolution. And these flat earthers, a lot of these new agers, they're a lot of new age. And I'm not going to mention the names, but I know of Shill. I know of Shill. Some of the Shills. I've investigated a little bit. And I'm going to be really, I'm going to confess to everybody, it's embarrassing. Because they get you going. Oh, they string the line out there. They string it out there, boy. Boy, it sounds good, hey, boy. Let me nibble on that one for a while. But nobody is talking about who got all this bullshit started. I'm going to tell you something. There's a Jesuit under every rock.
Yeah.
and that's what it is. It's another distraction. They're getting everybody. I mean, look what's happening here. In 3 months, we got the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist, a Nazi, coming to speak to the joint session of Congress. And we're talking about flat Earth.
I am not.
No, I'm not either. I do want to say this. I believe the Earth. I believe in geocentric. Okay. I believe what the Reformers believed in. And they didn't believe this Earth going 66,000 miles an hour. And you can go out here to the North Star, put up a camera, and point it at the North Star. And everything is spinning around the North Star. We're going 66,000 miles an hour and turning to 1,000 miles an hour, and that North Star stays in the same place. Anybody with two neurons can, but you know something? You know what is exciting to me? Every single university teaches heliocentric.
Of course.
And if you walk into a classroom and you bring up geocentric, you are going to be labeled a Looney Tune.
Yeah, and then things like to Kent Hovind will happen to you.
That's right, because he was stepping on their religion.
And they don't see it as a religion. That's their big problem.
Yeah.
I mean, they know it is a religion, and they teach it as a religion, but they will never admit it. That is their religion.
And there isn't anything more insane than evolution.
You know, to me, it just goes back to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. So, I do not discuss with anybody who doesn't believe the same thing, because there's no discussion possible. Because this is the Bible I'm talking about, and the Bible is the Word of God.
That's right. That's right. I believe in a literal 6-day creation, not a 6,000. I mean, every day is 1,000. And I'm going to tell you something. This is a good time to insert this, because I met a man that was raised in Bavaria. He was in the Hitler Youth when he was 17.
Oh, Paul, you again.
And he and I had a chance. It's a long story. I'm not going to go into how, but anyway, I told him he wanted to meet me in Seattle. I said, well, that's too far. I said, but if you come all the way to Roseburg, I'll come over and pick you up. And he came down, and I spent 4 days. He was 17 years old,
and it was amazing. Listen, I was still, I didn't have legs. See, I didn't have legs. But I remember having him out at Port Arthur on an old Coast Guard station, and there was a government sign, and something about the Ice Agers. And I made a comment. And he went, you've seen pictures, and I'm not knocking this because he's German, okay? But he was raised in Bavaria, okay? It's 99.99% where he lived, and Catholic, the Protestant Reformation never got to Bavaria. It's real important to know that, because once you know that, that's where the National Socialists came out of. They came out of Bavaria. They didn't come out of Berlin. And anyway, I was out there, and he went ballistic. I didn't know what to say. It sounded like Adolf Hitler, some of the speeches I've seen. He went nuts. And I had the book. And he wrote his own Bible. He had been to a Bible college, and he lacked one quarter of passing. He's got his own Bible. And he was getting ready. He was working on Luther's Bible. I was talking to a real live Jesuit coadjutor, and didn't even know it. But once you put these pieces together, now you understand evolution. They had to destroy the faith. Whether you were Episcopalian, whether you were a Mormon, didn't matter. They had to take the faith away. They had to take their faith so they could become your God. And now they're coming over here. The Pope's coming over here. The Antichrist is coming over here. He's going to tell us how to take care of our global warming. And they're going to give us a climate covenant. That's what this is all about. And I had a friend of mine. He went to college. He got straight A's. And he used to always talk about evolution, evolution, evolution. And I said, you know, I used to have honeybees, and I worked in gardens, and I've never doubted that God didn't create. It took me only the last couple of years to realize how important what that was. And they started it with Galileo. They hijacked science. And it tells about us in Timothy, about the false science and the fables.
What's your time, Walt?
They've given us so many fables that if we started talking about the fables that they've given us, we could talk for hours. But with that, listen, I wanted to present the gospel delivered by Henry Grattan Guinness, but we've run out of time, and I didn't mean to. We never did get really back to the book, but there's some important things that I wanted to get off, that I wanted to share. Because it's been on my mind because a lot of the things that have been going on in the old world and what's about to happen. So with that, I'm going to close the broadcast. God bless, and I appreciate everybody for coming, and we'll catch you later. Bye for now. God bless.